This conference will now be recorded.
Welcome, everyone. I'm Commissioner Marcia Gershenson. I'm Vice Chairwoman of the Oakland County Board of Commissioners. In 2019, the Board of Commissioners formed a study group to examine best practices in animal welfare for our Oakland County Animal Shelter. From that group, it was agreed the best place to start would be to have an independent shelter assessment, and part of the process was a community meeting that you are all attending today. Can everyone go on mute? Thank you. Team Shelter USA will present their current recommendations based on their assessment of our Oakland County Animal Shelter and Pet Adoption Center. We've received many comments and questions, and several of you have had the opportunity to speak with Dr. Pizano herself. Many of your questions have been incorporated into this presentation, and some will be addressed at the end of the presentation. If you have any questions that have not been addressed, please feel free to send them to me or Amy Aubrey at the emails that are on the screen. Your input has been a valuable part of this process, and some of your great suggestions will be a part of Team Shelter's final report to the Board of Commissioners. Thank you all for your time and activism. And it's my pleasure to now introduce Dr. Sarah Pizano, founder of Team Shelter USA.
Thank you so much, Commissioner, and welcome everybody. So I have Amy's email up there during the presentation. If you didn't have a chance to ask a question, you can email it to Amy. And as the Commissioner said, there will be follow-up. You will be receiving a link to this recording. So if you have to leave early or you want to share it with somebody, you'll have the link to the presentation and the recording. But thank you so much for everything that you do. I really appreciate you all attending. We're going to talk about best practices for animal shelters, and I give this generic presentation all around the country. And I have to say that all of your questions were amazing, great, and already things that I talk about and will be recommending. So we are on point and online together. So that's exciting. So the recommendations all kind of funnel back to several key places. One is the Association of Shelter Veterinarians Standards for Care of Animal Shelters, and of course, spay-neuter guidelines. And then the Million Cat Challenge, if you haven't heard about that, please join us at milliontcatchallenge.org. It's been a year now, I guess, have come out with fear-free sheltering certification. So if your organization has not been certified, please do the training. It's amazing. I did it. It's online, free, self-paced, and probably took me 3 hours or so, but I learned a lot, and I've been in animal welfare a long, long time. If you haven't heard about the Human Animal Services group, we are many hundreds of people strong across the country. We have weekly calls, several weekly calls, and if you don't know about that organization yet, I will talk a little bit about it, but it's Human Animal Support Services. Sorry, I forgot the support there, .org. All of these recommendations that are everywhere, like you can go on ASPCA Pro and learn about all these different things. You can go to bestfriends.org and find out best practices as well. What I did was, in my work doing assessments around the country, I compiled all these principles that I was saying over and over to shelters, and I published the best practice playbook for animal shelters It is available on Amazon as a hard copy, and the ebook is coming out soon. And it is a result of way over now 100 community and shelter assessments since 2013, 18 states. So I've been in the north, the south, the east, the west, small communities, large city, urban areas, high poverty rates, low poverty rates. And I have to tell you, I don't care if I'm in Dallas, Texas, or McCreary County, Kentucky, or Oakland County, Michigan, these are the same conversations. We're all facing the same things, and empirically, right? We have some variations, but the solutions are universal, and that's why I'm so excited you're joining us today. As you all know, because you work in animal welfare, you know that this system of shelter intake is flawed. The traditional animal control and sheltering system really essentially has animals just flood in, no barriers to enter, everybody come in, and then all of us get gray hair, don't we? And we all panic, like, what the heck are we gonna do now? We're overcrowded, we don't have the resources, animals are getting sick. And then there's lots of self-imposed barriers from a lot of different layers. And this is really what I want you to keep in mind. Remember this funnel, because it's gonna come back in a different way. But it's because entering a shelter, first of all, it's scary, it's different, it smells weird. As much as we all try to make animals feel comfortable, it's very stressful for them. And when animals are stressed, people are stressed. If we allow animals to just flood in, we get overcrowded. Now we have lost our ability to protect them from disease, to give them the care and the special needs that they might have. We have decreased life-saving potential, and we're wasting resources. And this is about being really smart about our resources. But certainly, when a shelter is working over their capacity for care, we lost our ability to provide a fear-free environment. And that goes for all of you and all the pets. And remember, capacity for care is not just about shelter space. It's also about the people who care for them. So how many people, how many staff and volunteers do we have? So capacity doesn't mean just shelter space. The other thing that we do in animal control is we focus a lot on the things that we don't have control over, and it makes us feel really helpless. And so when we think about it, there is a whole heck of a lot more in our control than not in our control. So we can control, especially our local public policy, and thanks to the commissioner and the board, great things have been happening in your community. There's a lot of things, and that's what we want to focus on. We need to stop saying what we don't have and look at what we have and how to use it strategically. And it's not just money. It's not just shelter space. It's all of you. It's the number of staff and what the staff are doing. It's collaboration and how we're getting partners. They could be a car dealership. I don't even care what they are, but anyway, what do we have? Keep focusing on growing what we have and not focusing or wasting time on what we don't have. I will tell you that your shelter is not at baseline budget for the number of staff, because you don't have kennel staff or people cleaning the kennels. And I'm including cats in that as well, nor do you have adoption counselors. And so you're not at baseline, and the budget overall is on the lower side. We don't have a specific recommendation for the budget, but we do look at per capita. And there is a wide range per capita in the United States for animal control facilities, and it goes from $3 or so per capita up to about $23. And Oakland County is right around $4 or $5. So definitely on the low end. And so that makes all of you who are volunteering at the shelter, who are rescuing and pulling animals, that makes you so much more crucial. And I thank you for that. But again, this system is about working smarter, not harder, and reserving shelter space for animals that don't have any other alternatives, so that when we do bring them into the shelter, it's like summer camp. I want it to be like a hotel A fear-free, fun environment with a short length of stay. That's what LOS means, length of stay. That is our goal. If we can't find an alternative, we want them out of Dodge as quickly as possible to the best possible live outcome opportunity. And then euthanasia is reserved for what I call true euthanasia. So we define that as large, dangerous dogs who are not safe to rehabilitate, who none of the rescue groups think is safe to rehabilitate. Medical cases beyond hope, doesn't matter what resources we have, we can't save that particular pet. And remember, that 90% benchmark of live release rate is good to look at trends, but it is arbitrary. Because remember, you can have euthanasia just in those categories that I just mentioned and be at 75%, right? So this is changing nationally as we move forward, and public shelters in particular are getting better and better. But just so you understand where your shelter is compared to the national averages, Best Friends, bestfriends.org, you can look up this information. You look, I think the tab is No Kill 2025, and it might say dashboard or life saving. Click on that. There's a map of the United States. You can see what's happening in Michigan. You can hover over counties, and you can see how Michigan ranks in the United States. But just so you know that in the United States, overall, Best Friends from 2019 said the overall live release rate for dogs and cats is 79%. And your shelter in 2020 hit that magical 90%. So congratulations to all of you. Over the last 4 years, since I was analyzing statistics since 2017, and every year it's getting better and better. So amazing work to all of you, and congratulations. But that public policy is the basis. This is where we can really minimize, we can handcuff shelters, or we can minimize these downstream issues if we have responsible public policy. And by that I mean my public policy decisions are based on data and not folklore. And there are plenty of ordinances I review. And when I was public shelter director and started, my ordinance hadn't been looked at in 30 years. And just think about what's happened in 30 years, a whole heck of a lot. But that is the framework for whether it's a public or private organization. We need to make sure every level, whether it's county or municipality, is in line with best practices. And as you're trying to influence your local leaders, your commissioners and council people and mayors, remember what their goals are and speak their language. So they have a responsibility to provide public and animal safety, provide constituent services. They have to balance a budget, and they sure like to eliminate waste to do that. And they have set goals that they want to achieve. So in these conversations, you always have to remember that you need to address what their goals are and make sure you link what you're talking about and your goals with their goals. And that's when the magic happens. These are just some examples. I have a whole chapter in the best practice playbook for animal shelters on legislation, and there's charts, what to do, why to do it, and what not to do, and why not to do it. So there certainly should be no breed specific restrictions or legislation. There is absolutely no data. There is no information correlating breed specific restrictions with anything like public safety. There's no correlation. I know I'm preaching to the choir, but I also know that you have some municipalities with these very antiquated ordinances that need to be updated. Pet limits is another one. Pet limits in no way correlates to decreasing hoarding situations. Hoarding is a psychological issue. Sometimes it's accidental hoarding and access to care issue. But in any event, pet limits don't correlate to the goal. And this is where we need to educate our public officials and say, we get that that's your goal, but here, let's do, this is the pathway to that goal. You're not in line, you're not on your way to accomplishing that goal. No stray holds for cats. And this is a big one for me, because it drives me insane when I see a stray hold for cats, when the national average for reunification of shelter cats is a whopping less than 2%. At your shelter, it's around 5% or less. That's just a no-brainer, and we're gonna get to the community cat section in a minute. And then, of course, incentivizing sterilization with the reclaim in lieu of fees and fines. Again, it's all about access and having, how are we gonna prevent all these animals from flooding in the shelter, and that's a good way. And then making sure there's nothing else in our ordinances that are barriers to life saving. Enforcement is woven into that public policy, right? And one great example I love to talk about is the Santa Cruz program in California, because these officers just said, we're just tired of going to the same areas constantly. And so they said, we're gonna rotate and just be talking to neighbors and seeing what's going on and seeing how we can help. And they turn their high intake areas into low intake areas. They raised some in-kind donations. This wasn't any impact to their budget except good, because it decreased their intake from those areas. So what your field officers really do in the field really matters. There was a really good quarantine question. Somebody asked why animals would have to be in the shelter for the 10-day quarantine if they bit somebody, even if they're vaccinated. So the answer is they do not all have to be in the shelter, but they are taken to the shelter if there's some sort of extenuating circumstance, like maybe the owner cannot keep the dog in the yard or something like that. Whatever the case is, it's usually an extenuating circumstance, but it is not an automatic that they have to be quarantined at the shelter. And then the most powerful to me is those public-private partnerships, like all of you, and you're on here with the commissioner learning about how to help your public shelter. That is the most powerful collaboration. We know that when public and private entities partner and target spay-neuter subsidies, now I'm talking community, I'm talking about ways that we can help decrease shelter intake. We know that these are access issues, meaning that a fixed income pet owner, I know your highest intake is from the city of Pontiac, and it has a high poverty rate, right? So that is linked, and when we help, we subsidize spay-neuter for fixed income pet owners in particular, it correlates with decreasing intake. Some people might say, well, they shouldn't have pets. Well, let's just think about our goals and what we, if we want to accomplish something, there's more than 20 million Americans, many more than 20 million Americans on government assistance who have pets. And so we could say, well, they shouldn't have pets, but that's kind of a goal that we're never going to accomplish. So how about we just help them and subsidize that spay neuter so we stop that conveyor belt of puppies and kittens being born and growing up and being homeless and being from those high intake areas. Then we have our large breeds. I don't call out pit bulls, but I'm saying pitties are in the large breeds. So focusing our subsidies on these populations, including community cats, large breeds, of course, they're gonna have gigantic litters, more so than the smaller dogs, and they're hard to place when they're larger and all of those things. So these are great investments for municipalities. So that leads me to then, who are we taking into the shelter? Amy, I'm not sure if you're hearing this beeping, but it sounds like people are constantly coming. I'm not sure if there's anything you can do about that.
It's an error with somebody that's trying to join. I don't have control over it, but I think they may have gotten it figured out now.
Okay, thanks. I wasn't sure if you could hear that. Thank you. So now we're gonna talk about, there's animals that are in need of help. And remember that funnel, that traditional broken system. Everybody just comes in the shelter. It's an intake bias. This is what we have to change. We have to say, wait a minute, there's other ways that we can help people instead of taking them into the shelter. And that's why I use the word productively. We're still helping them. And that data needs to be captured. That workload at the shelter needs to be captured, or whatever you're doing needs to be captured. But we want to productively decrease intake. So we reserve shelter space for animals that really need us. So remember that funnel, we want to turn it upside down. Hey, we're going to help you in this way or that way. So you know what? We have a hoarding case. We have a cruelty case. We have an enforcement case. We need them to be in the shelter and we need staff to take care of them. So we reserve the space and then we remove barriers to live outcome, which we'll get at the end. If you're anything like me, I was very judgmental of people who were surrendering their pets to shelters. So I was very humbled by the studies that started to come out probably around 2015 to present that show that up to 80% of the pet owners that surrendered to shelters did not want to. They just needed temporary help that was not available for them. Holy cow, I was so heartbroken and humbled to read that. And I changed my philosophy and I released that judgment on a dime. And now I know what we should be doing is saying to people, what's the issue? How can we help you keep your pet or place your pet? I am not suggesting that the public shelter does this and pays for everything. And I am not suggesting that the private groups pay for this and that's the whole burden is on them. I'm saying these are the public-private partnerships we need to work together. Access to care is a huge issue, as it is, I know, in your community as well. You do have a couple of great programs, but it just seems like there's never enough. I want you to keep your eyes open for the open door model that we are introducing this year. And this is a model it could be for any clinic, but it was started as a for-profit private practice model to prove that you can have access to care and a financially viable private practice. And so there's one in Asheville, North Carolina, and there's one in Toledo, Ohio. And now we're helping other clinics do the same to increase access to care. So very exciting. But back to that managed admission, and in Brevard County, the sheriff runs the shelter. And we told them, listen, we really think you can help people. And even if you help like 30% of the people or 10% of the people, it's going to be less animals coming into the shelter. And look what they did, you guys. The very first year, shelter intake of owner surrenders was decreased by 80%. And that was no impact to their budget. They just said, what can we link you to? How can we help you? And this is now they finished year four, and every year it's the same thing. They help about 80% of the owner surrenders so that those animals, only 20%, have to enter the shelter. In Jacksonville, Florida, at the public shelter, they were doing, way back when, they were euthanizing most of the animals. Years and years of hard work and collaboration in Jacksonville resulted in them ending euthanasia for space. So as they were transitioning and so happy, all of a sudden kitten season hit and they were flooded with animals again in the summer. And they just out of desperation said to the Good Samaritans, hey, listen, is there any way you can foster these babies or whoever, and we'll spay and neuter them, we'll vaccinate them, but keep them out of the shelter so that we aren't faced with euthanizing animals for space. And I hope you can see this. My screen, it's covered, but the numbers, first year, they used to send about 450 animals to foster care a year. And in the first year, they increased that to over 3,700 animals a year. Now, this didn't mean they got stuck in foster care. They have an excellent conveyor belt, I call it, of live outcome. And so those animals go in foster care and get adopted really quickly. So really amazing program, proving that Good Samaritans want to help. You just need to give them the opportunity. Home to home is another thing that I recommend at every shelter, including Oakland County. This is it is actually the brainchild of the Panhandle Humane Society in Idaho, but they've made it national thanks to a grant from Maddie's. And this is basically an online presence on the Facebook page and the website of the shelter, where the shelter can post a person's pet who is in need of a home, but the owner keeps the pet and the match is made directly. So the communication is between the person who's interested in adopting and the person who needs an adopter. So a direct home-to-home placement, but facilitated by the shelter, because the shelter is having eyes on it looking for animals to adopt. And so a great way to enable and empower, we know now that people will help and will step forward and come up with all kinds of solutions if we empower them and link them. So all of these things that I'm talking about, managed admission, the safety net, having fosters on deck, meaning I know that before these animals even come to the shelter, I have a whole waiting list of fosters that the animals are going to go right out to foster. That makes the biggest impact, especially on these large breed dogs. And some of you have asked about reactivity and placing them and long lengths of stay and all of those things. I don't talk about those things until we make sure we have the best safety net, manage admission, and foster on deck program to make sure we're doing everything we can so that they don't enter the shelter, because it's a hard environment, especially for these big guys that have a lot of energy. They really have, they need outlets, and it's a tough environment for them. So we're gonna come back to that, but I wanna go next to the cats. So cats, we know from the best friends data, we know that they are twice as likely to be euthanized in shelters versus dogs. Thank goodness not many animals were euthanized at your shelter last year, which is amazing. But nationally, we know that 80% of cats entering to shelters in are stray, which I'm doing rabbit quotes for those of you who might be listening and not watching, because they're not really stray. Cats are much smarter than people, and they're not lost. So these are community cats. They might be friendly or they might be unsocialized. It doesn't matter. Someone is caring for them. How do I know? And let me digress and say, I thought this, what I'm gonna talk to you about, the shelter new to return in TNR, I thought was the craziest thing I ever heard way back in 2005 when I was a shelter director. But holy cow, it's undeniable that we have been doing the wrong thing. And now we know what the right thing to do is. And I'm so thankful for your commissioners for approving the program in November of 2020, approving a community cat program. And so I'm going to outline the steps of recommendations and why these recommendations are foolproof, work everywhere, hands down, money back guaranteed. We know that, again, less than 2%, 5% of shelter cats are reunited with their families. So we know stray hold is not productive, but there is a proven solution and called lots of names. It might be called shelter new to return, or a bad one called return to field, which I hate, because you are not returning the cat to a field. You were returning the cat where they were already cared for. How do I know they were cared for? The cat is 10 to 12 pounds. They have a beautiful coat and they're looking at me like, you idiot, why do you have me in jail? I know exactly where my meals are. I have three families. I sleep on my bed, on my parents' bed, on their pillow every night. So please get out of my own way and open up the cage and put me back. So again, it could be friendly or unsocialized. And here's the thing, and I know, so first of all, a lot of you wrote in and said, why aren't we doing this program? So I know I'm preaching to the choir, but I'm hoping I'm gonna give you some tools as you're educating other people about why the shelter and the county are doing this program, because there's also municipalities that you need to convince. So we know that about half of cat owners, and that's estimated, let their cats out in and out. Some cats prefer to be outside. So why we've trained the public to bring a cat to the shelter in the name of it's lost, I don't know. I can only guess it's because we never had any data before. And then some people are bringing cats to the shelter saying, I don't want them on my property. And so we're going to talk about that as well. So this is the super highway for cats, and this is what should be happening. We have gobs of studies that show that less than 1% of these cats are too sick, ill, or injured to be put back. So we address that. Maybe occasionally there'll be some that are euthanized. Maybe there's occasionally reasons why they can't go back, but get your mind out of a colony. This is the one in two cats coming in at a time. This is colony prevention. So what should happen is if the cat, we're not asking for additional cats to come in the shelter, guess what? At Oakland County, those cats are already getting sterilized, so there is no budget increase. The only difference is I'm not holding them for a stray, and I'm gonna ask the Good Samaritan, hey, so here's our program now. The day after surgery, they come in the first day, they have surgery the second day. The day after surgery, they get put back where they were found. You might say, but why? The cat is friendly and we have space. Why wouldn't we put them up for adoption? Very good question. Why? Because they didn't need a home. They already had a home. So if you're a nonprofit, shame on you for wasting your donor dollars on a cat who doesn't need you. And if you're a public shelter, shame on you for wasting those time. So focus on the animals that need you. Then the Good Samaritans might say, oh, sure, I didn't know that was an option. In Greenville, South Carolina, first year, 1,500 cats were brought in by the public, and half of them, those Good Samaritans, came back and picked up the cats and brought them home and put them back where they were already cared for. So decreased the workload. So that return piece is the only thing that we have to work at Oakland County, which I think I have full confidence that we can. What about kittens? We get this question a lot. We would love to see kittens not grow up as ferals and all of that. But if they're already feral, chances are, and you all know who do kitten and cat rescue, how long it takes, and sometimes you can't unferal them. So if they're feral, we can put them back out. In Jacksonville, they put back anybody who's big enough for surgery. In other programs, if they're feral, they put them back. And if they're friendly, they go on adoption track, but not necessarily at the shelter, you guys. If the shelter has space, that's fine. But if the shelter at some point is overcrowded, then you don't want those most vulnerable babies in the shelter. They do, however, as you can imagine, have the shortest length of stay. If you have not seen the Leave Them Be videos that are out there, I mean, there are just so many great ones. Pasco County is one. Stray Cat Alliance in Los Angeles has a great one. So many great videos explaining to the public, and this should be a pop-up on every shelter website, public and private, don't kidnap the kittens. Those moms that are nursing those babies have to get something to eat. The kittens are plump and healthy and clean and all of that. They don't need our intervention. We have to learn the difference, because people typically panic and bring kittens to the shelter in droves, expecting the shelter to have all the resources, right, to take care of them, which they don't. And the mother's the best one. So in short, that shelter new to return, there is really no downside at all. It's fiscally responsible, whether you're a public or private shelter. It provides sustainable resolution. How about this? Oakland County hasn't done this program before. So between 2017 and 2020, like every other shelter that's not doing community cat programs, cat intake's going up. What happens when every single shelter does this? Intake plummets, euthanasia ends. Now we stop the population explosion in that area so we don't get the kittens. Next year, in the last part of the summer, next year again, as all these kittens grow up, we drastically decrease the number of cats and kittens out there, and we increase community immunity against rabies because they're all vaccinated. When we have less cats outside, we have less impact on wildlife, because we want to be sensitive to all animals, including wildlife. And at the shelter, when our intake decreases, we have more resources for dogs. And resources could be you, right? Volunteers, rescues, all kinds of things. So this is some great visuals about this program and the decreased intake in euthanasia. So this happens to be Nashville, but this is trends same everywhere. The green is live outcome, and the blue is euthanasia. So look at that dramatic year. The beach bar is a year. Look at the dramatic decrease in intake, the dramatic decrease in euthanasia, and the increase in live outcome. What about Waco, Texas? Poverty rate 30%, much higher than the national average. Look at that very first year, which is the second bar of the community cat program and safety net. I mean, it's really staggering. These are trends that don't happen any other way, because God knows we've been working a long time doing the same thing. Definition of insanity. If you look back and Waco numbers, it was the same numbers and same trends every year. Look at Greenville, South Carolina. First year, boom, decreased euthanasia by about 1,000 cats, decreased intake by 2,000. I'm sorry, decreased euthanasia by 2,000 cats. And the second year continued to go down. When I was in Greenville back, must have been the end of 2015. Those cats were packed in tiny cages with no portals because they had no space. The staff couldn't imagine doing it another way. When I went back in 2016, 17, just to visit, this guy was the only feline in adoptions. And look, now he has a portal. He was the only one there. It's so remarkable to me still. And I've been doing this a long time. I'm gonna stay on this slide for a few minutes because I want you to make sure you watch this webinar, which is just chock full of studies and research that'll help you not just educate yourself, but as you're educating other people. This is our webinar that we did. It was the beginning of 2020. It was right before the pandemic broke, and it's at milliontcatchallenge.org. You're gonna have this presentation, but I wanna point out in particular, the name of it is the Cat Superhighway. And that's the link there, but it's just a one-stop shop for every question that you might have. So now I'm talking about all the ways we're gonna decrease intake so that if animals come into shelter, it's the shortest length of stay possible. And this needs to be no different than a summer camp. And when you say that, or I say that, we think like, oh my gosh, how could that ever happen? Well, guess what? It's already happening at Pima County in Arizona. Pima County is a big public shelter handling 20,000 animals a year. And at the beginning of COVID, they had to pivot, right? They had to close limit the number of hours, and their staff was getting sick and all of those things. So they said to their community, oh my gosh, we need fosters. Can anybody help us? So guess what? Fast forward, this is how Pima County works now. If an animal, they can't find an alternative, and an animal comes into their shelter today, it is there for less than a day because it goes to a foster on deck, which most of the time it gets either adopted in that home or that foster finds them a home. And guess what else happened? They have a lot of space in their shelter. So people were going back to work during the pandemic and as things are continuing to get better. And so now they'll drop their dogs off for doggy daycare at the shelter where they have play groups and all kinds of fun. Everybody keeps advocating for the dogs to get adopted, and then the fosters pick them up at night and take them home for the night and do the same thing when they go to work the next day. So we never thought, right, that these kinds of things could happen. The pandemic, I think, was one of the best things that ever happened for animal welfare. As tragic and hard as it's been, it really has catapulted these really amazing, these best practices that some of them like that, we've never even saw that coming, but it's really helped a lot of shelters get confidence to try all these things that we're recommending. But if they come into the shelter, we wanna make sure we're advocating for them right away, whether they're strays or owner surrenders, that they're on our website, that we are allowing everybody to see them, all of that, and certainly convenient hours. The hours now at your shelter are linked to being understaffed. And so the shelter does want to open 2 evenings a week. The shelter does want to open on the weekends to the public, but they don't have enough staff to do so. So you, somebody did, a couple people commented on this, and this is again something we talk a lot about, is hours for the public have to be convenient for that live outcome. Remember those barriers? So when you're open 10 to 5, that's a barrier for people who work a normal job, like in an office, because that's what people usually work. So convenient hours, yes, absolutely, is really important. And remember, I'm making these recommendations, and some of them can be done super quick. No need for funding, will even be a cost savings. And then other things will take county executive approval, commissioner approval, things like municipal approvals, contract renegotiations, things like that. So some things can happen really quickly. Some things might take time, and some things the leadership might decide not to adopt, but I certainly hope that they will adopt all the recommendations, of course, or I wouldn't have made them. But anyway, again, not negotiable. When animals come in the shelter, we are obligated to have the appropriate housing for them and enrichment. And this includes play and normal exercise. And somebody asked about dog reactivity and how hard it is to walk dogs, because when you walk by other dogs, everybody goes crazy. And I know that. And that's why I'm so excited about play groups, because this is, again, something that I never thought could be possible, having a whole bunch of big dogs playing in a group together. But boy, do we know different now. There are two kind of schools of thought, two main groups that do national training, and you all need to get together and decide which group you want to have come do training. Sometimes there's grants for these things. Sometimes you do have to pay for it. One is called Dogs Playing for Life, and one is called Shelter Play Group Alliance. They have slightly different approaches, but get somebody needs to come and train staff and volunteers. In some places, this is all volunteer run. But here's what we know. And walking dogs is great, but there's nothing that provides the benefits like play groups and normal play and interaction. There's a recent fear-free study that showed 45 minutes of play off leash reduced stress hormones in dogs for 24 hours. This reduces when I walk into a shelter, I can already tell you what's happening with enrichment, whether it's thumbs up or thumbs down, or you need to do more. When dogs are coming to the front of the cage and reacting and barking, spinning certainly, and all of those different things, they are not getting the enrichment that they need. And this is very, 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 very common in shelters. And so that's why play groups, when you have, because there's only so many volunteers, there's only so many hours in the day, play groups are much more efficient. And if you read the Dogs Playing for Life annual report, you'll see that these play groups in shelters decrease length of stay and increase adoption rates. What an amazing way to get great videos and things of animals. So that is my, at the beginning of COVID, I fostered Potato. That is her. That is on her first trip to Petco. And yes, you are correct. Her last name is now Pizano. I am not a foster failure. I am a successful adoption. So that is my cue. I want to show you this, just a few minutes of this video that is just still so crazy to me. But this is at Palm Beach Animal Control, and you notice the dogs have leashes on. The staff and volunteers are trained to understand normal dog behavior and understand how to introduce new dogs into the group. It doesn't have to be this big, it could be less dogs. But gosh, she goes, I don't know that. I mean, if you told me this could be done, I would say there's just no way. And look at these dogs, happy, playing, And again, this video was shot by their volunteer trainer, but it could be staff or volunteers. So I encourage you all to big recommendation for Oakland County and every shelter. So the next topic is adoptions. And again, one thing we do in animal welfare is, oh, there's not enough good adopters here, so we have to transfer or what have you. What we know is that Best Friends did a study, and we know we have a lot more data than that, but they did a study that showed that 76% of those people who went to breeders or pet stores, who, by the way, I was judging, had already been to a shelter or rescue group, and it was too cumbersome, too difficult, too invasive, or they were denied, like my three vet school classmates told me on separate occasions. So make no mistake, there's no shortage of adopters, but our own fears are a very, very serious barrier to life saving. And again, another very humbling document for me was Adopters Welcome. This is by the Humane Society of the United States. It's a quick read. I encourage you all to read it tonight, animalsheltering.org. You could read it for free. You could order it for $15, but it's a quick read. It is chock full of why the most important thing is making the right match and trusting that more people are good than bad. And the key things to a successful adoption program and short length of stay is to educate people and set expectations before the adoption, to have certainly, and then post-adoption, make sure you have a callback service. So it could be all volunteer, hey, how's it going? Okay, let me help you with that housebreaking situation or that pulling situation on the leash or what have you. It needs to be an easy, convenient process. I am a huge advocate for fee-waived adoptions. Was I in 2005? Heck no. I thought I had to charge a lot for an adoption to make sure it was a good home. Read Adopters Welcome. Boy, was I proven wrong over and over, study after study. There's no correlation. First come, first serve with rescue groups. So all of these principles apply for rescue groups as well. Open adoptions, best conversation, conversational adoptions to get them in the best placement. Behavior temp tests is also something that I talked to the shelter staff and leadership about. That is Potato getting her laser treatment. She's very much a diva now, as you can imagine. I just admitted to you that I was judgmental of people. We know there are breed-specific ordinances in your community. These are all discriminatory and unfair. So we all collectively need to stop judging people and stop judging shelter animals, in particular bully breeds, unfairly. We know beyond a shadow of a doubt that the media has unfairly portrayed bully breeds. And I read something somewhere, somebody said, yeah, but these are strong dogs, they're energetic, they need training. And I said, absolutely they do. What about the 80-pound mixed breed? Can't you say the same for them? Of course. What about the pointer that is trained to hunt? I mean, they have a hybrid drive too. Like, so all dogs need training. We need, as animal welfare experts and supporters, to not perpetuate those myths. Temperament tests were developed by the ASPCA, the SAFER method, for example. But what they realized was, again, dogs were getting labeled unfairly, and now their position statement says, time out. Like the behaviors you're seeing in the shelter do not correlate to behaviors in the home. So you want to write down, you want to put in the record, here's what happened. We want to know, we want to use that information to make the best match. But there was a temp sort of test at the shelter that I recommended be stopped immediately, and it was. But the important thing is to capture that information so we can make the right match. I want to thank everybody for listening, for sending in your questions. I do have a Facebook page. I'm not the best on social media, but you can follow me on social on Team Shelter. And again, the playbook is on Amazon. I'm going to check my text now from Amy to see if there's any more questions. But again, there's answers that we don't have right now because the recommendations have not even gone to the leadership or the commissioners yet. We wanted your input first. So you have Amy's email there and you have Commissioner Gershenson's email there. And I want to thank the commissioners so much again. So let me check out the text. Okay, the first question is about DOG, which is Do Only Good, and they are the rescue group that is the nonprofit for the last 7 years that has done the adoptions for the bully breeds. And the question is, how is it fair that they can transfer the dog for $10.50 and then charge $125 for the dogs for adoption? So I did ask those questions of the leadership and of DOG, and here's what I found out, that it is, the shelter is open to other rescues. So if you are a rescue and want to transfer animals, please contact the shelter. It would go through the county, and you would do the same thing. You would pay $10.50 to transfer an animal. And no different than any other nonprofit, you can charge what you want. But again, V-Wage is gonna get animals placed quicker. And people say, well, how are we gonna make money? Well, it is your job as a nonprofit to raise money in other ways than an adoption fee, which might prevent them from getting in a really good home. With DOG, they also told me that that fee is put towards a trainer so that the adopter does get a training session, and then there are fee-waived pets too. So those are heartworm dogs. They might be dogs that have been there for a long time. But if you're a rescue group and want to pull, please reach out to the shelter and do that. That would be great. So that was it. I think I answered all of the questions there. That we got. So I wanted to invite Commissioner Gershenson back on if you wanted to make any closing remarks, Commissioner.
Arch, are you awake?
Thank you, Sarah. I look forward to getting your report and to sharing it with the other commissioners. And I just wanted to thank you for all the time you put into this study. And we look forward to getting your report and following through on many of your recommendations. So thank you everybody for joining, and I hope people will stay in touch.
Thank you so much. Thanks everybody. Bye-bye.